I'm so glad that you're all here. It's a pleasure to welcome you. I'm Biddy Martin. It's an even greater pleasure and an honor to introduce a leader with the vision, the talent, and the courage of Cornell William Brooks. Cornell William Brooks, as you know, many of you, I think, is the president and CEO of the NAACP, the National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, an organization that has its beginnings, or had its beginnings, well over 100 years ago. Having officially started in 1908 in response to a race riot in Springfield, Illinois, that resulted in the death of 8 black people and spurred a mass exodus from Springfield, Illinois. More than 2,000 African Americans left the city. But it actually has its roots further back in 1905, when W.E.B. Du Bois and William Monroe Trotter founded a civil rights group called the Niagara Movement. And what distinguished the Niagara Movement from other black organizations of that time was the unequivocal, uncompromising demand in 1905 for civil rights, which they sought through both social and structural change. The NAACP, in a sense, grows out of the Niagara Movement. And it defined its mission from the beginning as, quote, ensuring that the political, educational, social, and economic equality of minority group citizens in the United States. And over its long history, the NAACP's legal and legislative advocacy has included a 30-year campaign against lynching, pushing through fair employment practices, the Civil Rights Acts of 1957, 1964, 1968, and the Voting Rights Act of 1965. The NAACP even blocked the appointment of a Supreme Court nominee, John J. Parker, in 1930. Cornell William Brooks is the 18th president, and he is tasked, or has tasked himself, with carrying that extraordinary history forward in an ongoing fight against racial discrimination and economic inequality in the United States. He was carrying it with him when he led America's Journey for Justice, which was a 1,000-mile march from Selma, Alabama, across 5 states to the nation's capital in support of voting rights and in protest against the Supreme Court decision in Shelby v. Holden that put voting rights at risk again. And he marched the entire way. He put that history to work in 2016 when he was arrested during Democracy Awakening, a record-setting week of civil disobedience that the nation called, quote, the most important protest of the 2016 election, end of quote. And he was carrying that history with him when he was arrested again on January 3rd of this year for leading a sit-in at the Alabama office of Senator Jeff Sessions. He was carrying it in solidarity with workers battling anti-union activity in Mississippi this month. As a civil rights attorney, a social justice advocate, a fourth-generation ordained minister, Cornell William Brooks is often praised for his capacity to build coalitions. It seems clear that his success comes from a willingness to put all of himself and the clout of the NAACP on the line in service of a greater good. This February, he publicly addressed the NAACP's motives for organizing an economic boycott in North Carolina by saying the following, quote, the federal court has declared and North Carolina citizens have discovered that partisan legislators are discriminating in the voting booth, school bathrooms, the workplace, and across the state. Seldom has such a poisonously partisan feud violated the rights of a nonpartisan many: workers' rights, LGBTQ rights, civil rights, and voting rights. Therefore, he continued, the NAACP must use the power of the purse to demonstrate the power of our democracy. End of quote. Cornell William Brooks graduated first from Head Start. He got his undergraduate degree at Jackson State University. He went on to earn a Master of Divinity from Boston University School of Theology. He then earned a JD from Yale Law School, where he was on the Law Journal. During his 4 years as a trial attorney for the U.S. Department of Justice, he worked to secure what was then the largest government settlement ever for victims of housing discrimination. He filed the government's first lawsuit against a nursing home, alleging housing discrimination based on race. He also worked for 8 years as a special and senior counsel to the Federal Communications Commission and directed the Office of Communication Business Opportunities, working to increase financing for small businesses and minority and women-owned businesses. He has successfully led the NAACP in legislatures, courts, communities, in opposition to racial profiling, police misconduct and violence, and voter suppression. His vision for the NAACP, he says, is that it be a multiracial, multi-ethnic, multi-generational army of millions of members. In 2014, as he began his work as president of the organization, some in some newspapers alleged that he was a surprising choice. Not for any bad reason, simply because those journalists, I guess, hadn't heard about the work he had done in New Jersey and elsewhere. I don't think anyone would say that anymore. I find it particularly appropriate that he'd be speaking here at a college to young people, given his strong advocacy for youth, which comes through over and over again in his vision and activism. In the fight against voter suppression, for example, he has emphasized youth in ways virtually no one else has. And in his vision of the future, he's written, "We have to get out of the way of our young people and let them lead." In a speech entitled "No Ordinary Time" that he gave in 2014, Cornell William Brooks closed by saying, quote, "This is no ordinary time." That was 2014. "This is a moment," he said, "to stand for our children, our youth, and our elders. This is a moment to stand for our country. Now is the time. Come stand with me." Let's stand with him, Cornell William Brooks.
Good evening. Now, if I were at Williams College, that good evening would suffice. But this being Amherst, good evening.
Good evening.
Okay, I know I'm in the right place. I want to extend a word of appreciation to your president, President Martin, who I think this would be the only thing that she would share with our president, namely that she tweets at odd hours of the day and night. And I sent her a note, and she was kind enough to respond back, and we've become Twitter buddies. And I had no idea that that would lead to me being here this evening. And to her, I want to simply say thank you. Thank you for your hospitality. Thank you for your leadership, particularly at this moment in our nation's history. I also want to extend a word of appreciation to the Black Student Union. And I'd like to ask President Diaz Madam President, if you can just wave your hand. Is she here? Okay, I tell you what. The members of the Black Student Union, if you all are present, can you all just stand up? Okay? Okay. Thank you. Yes, okay. Thank you. Thank you. My staff made it a point to emphasize who I should recognize, but I wanted to express appreciation to the Black Student Union, who you represent a vanguard generation of leaders, and that you were in fact preceded by Black alumni who are here. And so the African-American alumni who are here this weekend, if I can ask you to just stand on your feet that we might recognize your presence here. Thank you for indulging me. I was raised by a very Southern grandmother, Mrs. Rosalie Prelo, who taught me to always acknowledge those who made it possible for you to be where you are. And I wanted to acknowledge President Martin. I wanted to acknowledge the students in the Black Student Union, as well as the alum. I also want to express my appreciation to the students and faculty here at Amherst. You represent an extraordinarily proud tradition of justice seeking, as attested to by a man by the name of Charles Hamilton Houston, who founded the legal department of the NAACP, who served as the architect of the Brown versus Board of Education strategy and litigation, and who served as a mentor to a young former party boy by the name of Thurgood Marshall, who survived not a few parties as an undergraduate, but really turned serious at Howard University Law School. And I want to simply say to you that you represent an extraordinary tradition as represented in the lineage and legacy of Judge William Hasty, also an Amherst graduate, also a graduate of Harvard Law School. Both Hasty and Houston served many years, before Barack Obama on the Harvard Law Review. I think that has a little something to do with Amherst College. I also want to express appreciation to the members of the NAACP. And if there's anybody who is a member, or you've been a member, are you thinking about being a member? I want you to wave your hand so we can just express appreciation for all that you do. Thank you very much. Now, lastly, I want to just, please indulge me, I want to express appreciation to my wife of this many years. We met when I was a freshman in college, Janice Broome Brooks, whom I was in love with then, I am in love with now, and I just want to express my appreciation for her. And also my sons who are here, Hamilton, who is a junior in high school, and Cornell, who is a sophomore here at Amherst. I won't ask them to raise their hands. They won't let me go home. I want to simply begin by saying I've not always been so fortunate to be in the midst of such an august and distinguished group of students and faculty and friends. In fact, I can think of a time many years ago when I found myself standing outside of a building like this in London, England, London, England, a beautiful building, a beautiful cathedral with spires soaring toward the heavens, stained glass windows reflecting the multi-hued, multicolored, iridescent beauty of God. And as a young, naive, presumptuous preacher, I assumed that inside of this beautiful cathedral, there were 2,000 or so people waiting to hear this young, naive, presumptuous preacher preach. Now, I made my way into the sanctuary, and I immediately noticed the obvious. The pastor and exactly two members. True story. One member I'll call Miss Jones. The other member I'll call Miss Smith. Now, I did as I was taught to do, which is to say that you share, you teach, you talk to two people in the same way that you would to 2,000, with sincerity, with conviction, with a sense of one's anointing. So I began to preach, and I immediately noticed the obvious that Miss Jones immediately fell asleep. True story. This inspired me to only preach with greater fervor, greater conviction, and I immediately noticed the obvious that Miss Smith seemed to hang on to every word I had to say. She tapped her toes, she clapped her hands, she nodded her head, she said amen and hallelujah at all the right liturgical and theological moments. And I thought to myself, at least I'm reaching one somebody this Sunday morning. Well, I concluded my little homily, made my way out of the pulpit, made my way to the side of the pastor, and the pastor said to me, "Brother Brooks, I'm just so sorry. Miss Jones falls asleep on everybody. And Miss Smith is out of her mind and did not understand a thing you had to say." True story. True story. So you can see, well, I'm just so delighted to be here in the midst of this distinguished crowd with everyone being wide awake. We find ourselves tonight as a community of students and faculty, as a community of citizens and those who aspire to be citizens, at an anguishing hour of our democracy. It is an anguishing hour of our democracy where literally millions of Americans stand symbolically on the marble steps of the Supreme Court, on the outside looking in the wake of the Shelby versus Holder Supreme Court decision, in the wake of which there has been nothing less than a Machiavellian frenzy of voter disenfranchisement. This is a moment in our democracy in which many are trembling in fear, having survived a presidential campaign in which we saw racism routinized, anti-Semitism normalized, Islamophobia de-exceptionalized, and misogyny mainstreamed. It is a moment in our democracy in which we have seen a vicious vectoring upward of anti-Semitism and racism and hate crimes across the length and breadth of our republic. It is a moment in which we've seen nothing less than 1,000 hate crimes committed since Election Day, most of which have taken place not in bars, not in the streets, but in our K through 12 schools. Why? Because our children are emulating the conduct of the adults. This is an anguishing hour of our democracy in which so many or wondering whether or not we can be the nation we are called to be, wondering whether or not we can be the America we should be, wondering whether or not we can be the democracy we aspire to be, wondering whether or not this generation can live out the true meaning of this American creed. This is a moment in our democracy in which we look across the length and breadth of the land, and we yet see a conscious and woke and aware generation of millennial activists in the streets who assert with their minds, with their bodies, with their very beings that Black lives matter. They assert this moral proposition with the understanding that Black Lives Matter is the moral predicate to the ethical conclusion that all lives matter. Unless the first is true, the second can never be true. It is a moment in which we have a generation who are literally with their very bodies yet declaring the words of William Shakespeare, "Now is the winter of our discontent," and we refuse to be discontented perpetually. We will stand up for our democracy. We will stand up for our rights. We will stand up for the least of these. We can stand for our democracy in our time. And so at this anguishing hour of our democracy, we are reminded of a prophet who came to prominence in Montgomery, Alabama. A prophet whose first civil rights position was as a member of the executive committee of the Montgomery branch of the NAACP. His name was the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. And years ago, he lifted up a political parable in which he described and talked about a man by the name of Rip Van Winkle, who went up the side of a mountain, fell into a narcoleptic nap, slept for two decades, woke up, came back down the mountain. And we note on the way up the mountain, there was a sign with King George on it. On the way down the mountain, there was a sign with George Washington on it. Rip Van Winkle slept through a revolution. But there's a generation of Americans who have no intention of sleeping through a revolution. In fact, they are committed to forming a revolution. They would be the students in this very room at this very hour because they are committed to a woke democracy. And the reason at this hour, some of us are declining to join a committee of hand-wringing pessimists, skeptics, and cynics who yet declare that in the midst of this Twitter age civil rights movement, we can outsource our activism to the next generation, concluding we've done enough. We, with any sense of history, understand that there is much to be hopeful about, much to be confident in when we look at this generation of activists who are very much connected to a previous and previous generations of activists. Think about where we are with respect to criminal justice reform and voting rights. When we consider in the wake of Trayvon Martin's death, the Black Lives Matter movement was born with a hashtag and a visceral commitment to reform, to justice, and predicated with an affection and a love for Blackness, not to the exclusion of any other hue or heritage, but with an understanding that unless you love yourself, you're ill-positioned to love anybody else. And so, in the wake of Trayvon Martin, in the wake of Michael Brown, in the wake of Sandra Bland, in the wake of the death of an Afro-angelic young man, 12 years old, by the name of Tamir Rice, in the wake of the Emmanuel Nine, we've seen nothing less than the emergence of a Twitter age civil rights movement. We see in the context of criminal justice reform, literally an army of activists who are calling for us to engage in a reform and revolutionary project in the midst of our democracy, in the midst of our jails, in the midst of our prisons. When we think about the reality that a young black man is 21 times more likely to lose his life at the hands of the police than his white counterparts. When we think about the fact that in our cities and towns all across our country, we have many who regard the police not as officer friendly, but rather as an occupying army. There are many of us who've given our children the talk about the police because we are afraid of the police, because we understand that a minority of police officers, a minority of police officers are engaged in a form of policing which regards African Americans, members of the LGBTQ community, and Muslims as objects of suspicion, not subjects of protection. We understand that this is a moment in which we have 2.2 million Americans behind bars, 1 million fathers behind bars, 70 million Americans with criminal records. We represent 5% of the world's population, but 25% of the world's prison population. We understand it in our hearts and with a sense of history that there are more black men under the jurisdiction of the Department of Corrections in 2017 than there were black men as slaves under the jurisdiction of slavery in 1860. We understand that this is a sobering moment, but what have we seen? We have literally seen college students take on the challenge of banning the box, that small microscopic square on an employment application that yet poses the innocuous question, have you ever been arrested or convicted of a crime? And if you check that box, you literally check a lifetime of unemployment. We've seen students at Rutgers, we've seen students at Princeton ban the box in New Jersey and ban the box on college applications. We should be encouraged, not discouraged. We have seen young people all across the country assert with moral confidence that we can do things differently. They understand intuitively that this era of mass incarceration has to be brought to an end. They understand intuitively that this architecture of exclusion must be dismantled. They understand intuitively that a criminal record has become a digital mark of Cain. And young people also understand a bit about history. Some of you may recall the story of a law enforcement officer in Alabama who some years ago was searching in a storeroom and found at the bottom of a dusty box of photos, two pictures, two black and white photographs of a time gone by, two sepia-toned pictures of yesteryear. One picture depicted a beautiful middle-aged woman whose shy demeanor masked a fierce sense of determination, and yet her picture was the face like the grime of graffiti on a wall with these numbers, 7053, 7053, 7053. Beside that picture was the picture of a young man who possessed a precocious sense of moral maturity, a ministerial gravitas. And yet his picture was scarred with these numbers, 7089, 7089, 7089. We don't know the middle-aged woman by her arrest number. We don't know the middle-aged woman by her criminal record number. We don't know the middle-aged woman by the number 7053. We know her by the name of school that school children the world over call her Mrs. Rosa Louise Parks. We don't know the young man by his criminal record number. We don't know him by his arrest number. We don't know him by the number 7089. We know him by his name, the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. Everybody with a criminal record is not a crook. And so, a few years ago, when my colleagues at the New Jersey Institute for Social Justice and with the New Jersey State Conference of the NAACP, when we passed a ban the box bill, when we passed prisoner reentry legislation, when we passed bail reform, we did it standing side by side with students, side by side with millennial activists who understood that this legislation is predicated on the moral notion that if a man has paid his debt to society with the hard currency of responsibility, he deserves a second chance, particularly if he never had much of a first chance. This legislation, embraced by young people all across the country who are taking up criminal justice reform, is predicated on the moral proposition that a woman's worth cannot be measured by her arrest record or her rap sheet, but rather her worth and self-worth as determined by God. This is a moment in which we should be encouraged and inspired and believe in young activists. We cannot tut-tut and cluck our tongues on the sidelines of history. Why? Because we're mindful of an elder statesman by the name of John Lewis who sat down in the well of the House of Representatives in an act of civil disobedience. But we remember that the elder statesman John Lewis began as a 19-year-old firebrand. And before that, we remember that as a high school student from Troy, Alabama, he wrote letter after letter after letter to one old man by the name of the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King, and the Moses generation embrace the Joshua generation. If that was true then, it should be true now. We need a multi-generational fight for social justice in this country. The second realm in which we can be encouraged is in the realm of voting rights. President Martin has reminded you that constitutionally wrong-headed and morally wrong-hearted decision writ as Shelby versus Holder, which gutted the Voting Rights Act Section 5 via Section 4B, which unleashed this frenzy of voter disenfranchisement from one end of the country to the other. You recall in Texas, they passed this omnibus voter suppression law, which held that an ID which allows you to carry a concealed weapon is deemed sufficient civic and democratic proof to vote. But an ID which allows you to carry a book of statistics, a book of chemistry, a book of English, a book of Shakespeare, a book of poetry, a college textbook is deemed to be insufficient civic and democratic proof to vote. But 630,000 votes were imperiled, but students at UT Austin, students at colleges all across the state of Texas joined with the NAACP. We went to the Fifth Circuit and we won. Tell the hand-wringing pessimists to take note. In North Carolina, 5% of the electorate's votes were imperiled. Students all across the state joined the North Carolina State Conference of the NAACP, and they went to court before a conservative Fourth Circuit, and the Fourth Circuit declared that the actions of the North Carolina legislature were intentionally racially discriminatory, and that discrimination was carried out with surgical precision. But the students and the lawyers won. I know that there are some right now who are saying, well, we still have voter suppression. We still have racial profiling. We still have police misconduct. But may I remind you, in the course of this presidential campaign, the NAACP secured 9 victories against voter suppression in 10 months. May I remind you that the NAACP marched in Ferguson from the home of Mike Brown to the home of the governor, and we got past a law capping municipal fines. That is to say, when young African Americans and Latinos were rounded up, charged with minor offenses, and then fined, we got a law to put a cap on the fines and keep the police departments from preying on our young people. That's advocacy. May I remind you of the determination of our students? I can recall this tragic chapter in my life and that of the NAACP. 2 summers ago, we purposed in our hearts to march from Selma, Alabama to Washington, D.C., a journey of 1,002 miles across 5 states. We began in Selma, the birthplace of the Voting Rights Act, on a day of 103 degrees, heat index of 113 degrees, pavement at 109 degrees. And in Selma, I met a man whose chosen name was Middle Passage. Middle told us that he wanted to walk the entire distance from Selma, Alabama to Washington, D.C. for the right to vote. He told us that he wanted to inspire young people to stand against voter suppression and racial profiling. He told us that he wanted to meet young college students and engage them in the civil rights struggle. Middle Passage walked 40 days. We came to a little town in Virginia called Spotsylvania. We walked through a rainstorm, Middle having carried the American flag the entire distance. Middle Passage, 67 years of age. Middle Passage, a veteran of the Navy. Middle Passage, a veteran of the Vietnam War, carried the American flag through a rainstorm. But when the clouds parted, when the sun emerged, when the blue sky became clear, Middle unfurled the flag. And when he did, he collapsed to the pavement. My hardest day at the NAACP was explaining to a group of students that Middle didn't make it, that Middle didn't come back from the hospital, that Middle died. But the hardest question I've ever been asked at the NAACP was posed by those same students who asked, if a man was willing to die for the right to vote, why can't we vote and fight for the right to vote? So anybody who wants to say, wait your turn, anybody who wants to say this civil rights revolution, this is not what it was. No, it's not what it was. It can be better. I want you to look at history. I want you to look at this legacy here at Amherst and claim it. May I just leave you with this little historical footnote? It was a man by the name of Robert Purvis, born in 1810 in Charleston, South Carolina. A man whose lineage, ethnic lineage and legacy was African, Moroccan, English, and Jewish. He identified as black. This man, born a free black man, went to Amherst College, started the Anti-Slavery Society. This black man in 1838, when they took away the right to vote of free Africans in Philadelphia, he wrote an appeal to protect the right to vote. What began in 1838 is present in 2017. If Amherst led the fight then, it can lead the fight today. And just in case there's a hand-wringing pessimist yet in the room, I want to leave you with these modest words that are scrawled on a piece of faded manuscript and entombed in the rare book library of the Beinecke Rare Book Library on the campus of Yale University, and yet written on the hearts of millions of members and supporters of the NAACP. The words would be these: lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring. Ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoicing rise high as the listening skies. Let it resound loud as the rolling sea. Sing a song full of the faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the hope that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun of our new day begun, let us march on, let us march on, let us march on, let us march on, till victory is won.
So I'm going to read questions, and I know that Mr. Brooks will answer as many as he can in the time we have. So how can we overcome the barriers that obstruct intersectionality between minorities in our fight for social justice?
So one of the things that I'm extraordinarily encouraged by is the fact that we have a generation of scholar activists who are bringing fresh analysis. So in other words, for example, when we talk about intersectionality in the work of Kimberly Crenshaw, this work goes back decades. But it really is this generation of activists that has moved intersectionality from the realm of the academy into the streets. Now, that being said, we have to talk about intersectionality with respect to both ends and means. That is to say, both in terms of how we understand how oppressions and injustice interact and intersect, but also the way in which our goals and aspirations intersect. And what I mean by that is, if we're to build lasting, deep coalitions, it means that we have to have the analysis be interconnected, but also the activism. That's got to be real. And what I mean by that is, you can't have press release coalitions. You can't come together at the point of a crisis. You got to come together in real ways. And that means not just in the context of of the racial lens or ethnic lens, but also means in terms of religion. It means in terms of our immigration policy. It certainly means that in terms of the rights, in terms of gays and lesbians, transgender folk, people with disabilities. This requires deep analysis. Now, I'm not entirely sure that what we have is sufficient. In fact, I don't believe it to be. But I am confident that we're headed in the right direction. Last point on this is Dr. King talked not about intersectionality, but he talked about interdependence. I think it's important for us to understand that we need each other fundamentally.
Here, I'm trying to group them for you because we have so many. Here's a question: how can we break out of the comfortable progressive communities like this one to reach the hearts and consciences of the parts of the country who believe in what Trump is doing? And there's a similar one asking what practical ways we could get involved in that.
So that is a great question. Many of us in this progressive community come from communities that perhaps not so progressive. I come from the Lowcountry in South Carolina. The political atmosphere differs a little bit from Amherst College. And I was born in Texas. Let me begin by saying community is important. It's hard to communicate to people without being in community. And that means if you come from a place that's pretty conservative, you need to be in community. You got to engage people where they are. We need to not be afraid of the culture and the language of the people we embrace. So in other words, how many of you have seen people advocating on behalf of communities that don't love those communities? You know, if you look down on the way that people speak, the way they worship, the way they dance, you can't be an effective advocate. And what I mean by that is we've got to love the people who come from all parts of the country. And you'd be surprised at how persuasive you can be when you start from that premise. Now, going beyond that, we also have to understand the language of economics. So, for example, much of the criminal justice reform in this country, for example, the bills that we passed in New Jersey, much of this was predicated on engaging the business community, making sound, thoughtful economic arguments, business arguments, speaking in terms of shared interests without compromising our integrity. So when it comes to reaching the most conservative parts of the country, again, we got to be grounded. We got to be in these communities. You can't run ads. You can't do focus groups only. You got to be in the community. And when you do that, when you have real relationships, you're able to bring about reform. Now, in terms of how do we get involved in the work, one of the things I want to be clear about, it's a little hard to be in a movement unless you join the movement. That means by joining the movement, I don't mean merely tweeting and posting, although that is key, but it's tweeting, posting, joining, being present. Being present. Here's what I'm talking about. Can I give you all a real example? I remember in Ferguson having a group of millennial activists literally shout us off the stage, NAACP, with the argument being everybody on the stage is over 35, everybody in the audience is under 35. We're not having that. Legitimate argument. Here's what I found. When we spent 7 days walking 134 miles with folk, you build some real relationships. And when 500 of those same young people showed up in the capital of Missouri in the wake of Mike Brown's, the non-indictment of Officer Wilson, we had relationships. We can work with people. It's important for us, if you're going to get people engaged, to build relationships. It's old-fashioned, but it works.
There are two about gender that seem similar, not similar, they seem interestingly related. One is, do you have any words of encouragement and motivation for me and other Black women who feel abandoned and disregarded by Black men? And one from a young man who asks how Black men are supposed to stay woke when they're not respected.
Wow. Somebody told me these would not be easy questions. So in terms of African-American women as activists. Here's what I'll note. If you look at this Joshua generation of activists, many of them are African-American women, the founders of the Black Lives Matter movement, African-American women. If you look at the NAACP, if you look at the history closely, we need to be clear about this. People have this notion that, well, the CEO is a black man. True. But the first person who held my job was a white woman. The head of the board is an African-American woman. I want to say here that what we have to do is we've got to be more encouraging, more nurturing, more supportive, but we also have to understand, we got to appreciate strength. And what I mean is we can't be patronizing. In other words, if a sister comes to the table with the skill set, we need to accept her as an equal. And that means looking into the rooms and noticing when we see gender imbalance. It means looking at the board table in our organizations and looking for gender imbalance. It means looking at who, or not looking, listening for who's speaking and not being heard, and having the brothers in the room speak up. Now, with respect to brothers being woke and being respected, you know, one of the things that I want to be clear about is we all have to be woke and we all have to demand respect. Respect is seldom given. I mean, you recall when Frederick Douglass said that power concedes nothing without demand. That is particularly true with respect. And that means we literally as people, all people, this is not just a matter of ethnicity or gender. We all have to demand respect in our spaces. One of the things that I'm really heartened by, and again, I don't want to interfere or step into Amherst politics, but I got to say, I was incredibly impressed when y'all took on the mascot issue. I went to Yale, where we walked past John C. Calhoun College every day, and nobody thought of changing the name. And he was a slave owner. That shows me, demonstrates to me, that there's a consciousness. But the consciousness also has to be applied to ourselves, right? We got to have love for others, but we also have to have self-love as well.
There is someone in the audience who wants you to know that they walked the entire Middle Passage pilgrimage from Massachusetts to South Africa.
I want to meet you.
Wonderful. Thank you.
Madam President.
Yeah. Thank you. Here are two related questions. One is, what strategies would you try to implement to make capitalism a more inclusive system for minorities? And a related question, are you a socialist? Are you a socialist?
The first part.
What would you do to make capitalism more inclusive as a system for minorities?
So one of the things I will note here is, you recall Dr. King's last book, Where Do We Go From Here, Chaos or Community? Dr. King, who has been homogenized and sanitized and his economics analysis stripped of him, really moved toward socialism as we understand it. He had a very healthy critique of capitalism, which went back to his days in seminary. I subscribe to his philosophy that the capitalist system that we have, to the extent that it marginalizes, that it compounds race, it excludes people based on wealth, does not serve us well. Does not serve us well. Now, but I think this is bigger than simply declaring oneself a socialist. The system that we have right now demands radical reform. And what I mean by that is where we have in this country income inequality and income variability occurring at the same moment. And what we mean by this is it is not merely a matter of the poor not being as wealthy as the rich. It also means that the income of the poor, the working class, and the middle class is so fragile, so vulnerable, it swings so much from month to month that people literally have a rather tenuous grip on their economic well-being in this society. And so the point being here is when the largest banks are making decisions about how they extend credit based upon how tenuous your grip is on the middle class, you need to be concerned about people in the working class. That means we have to look at our economic policies in terms of job creation. We've got to talk about not just equipping people for jobs, presuming that they exist, but actually designing an economy to encourage job growth in terms of sustainable living wages, and doing something about literally the structural racial barriers in the job market. Concretely, when you have policies, i.e. collateral sanctions, that keep people with criminal records from working, you're not going to have viable cities. Plain and simple. And so all of us who want to live in hip cities, beside people who got criminal records who can't work, you're not going to have your coffee shop and your yoga studio unless you put some of these brothers and sisters to work. Okay? And that means a very, very thoughtful set of economic policies that have to do with capitalizing our cities. And I'd love to talk with anybody about social impact investing, procurement, employment, all that stuff, because I wonk out on that, but not tonight.
There are a few of this sort. What advice would you have for really making institutional change at a place like Amherst with the legacy we have? How can Amherst students be advocates and activists? And can you speak to the ways students can hold administrations and alumni accountable?
President Martin, I promise that my answer is not solely directed to you. I think it's incredibly important with respect to structural and institutional change at our colleges and universities is to think about your advocacy in the long term, meaning not just your class, next year's class, or class 2 to 3 years from now, but Amherst as an institution. For example, I went to an HBCU as an undergraduate. We, during that time, brought litigation challenging how historically black colleges and universities were funded. That litigation literally took 15 years in the courts. It went all the way up to the Supreme Court, but it represented a major infusion and investment in HBCUs. We had young activists on campus. We had a Save Black Colleges movement. Nothing of any major size or consequence, but we were trying to think about our institution generationally, not generations on campus, but a generation from now. And so I would just simply say to you, when you think about the alum who preceded you, all of these, affinity groups on campus and programs on campus, that work that they did back then is having an impact on your education now. So if you think about literally, what is this college going to look like 10 years from now, 15 years from now, 20 years from now? I think you need to think in those terms, not because that means delay, but it means literally big ambitions. And that's worthy of your advocacy. Second point I want to make here is, I think it's critically important to maintain dialogue even with those you oppose. Now, I can tell you, Senator Sessions and I are not best buds. He asked me when I met him, he said, "How was your time in Mobile?" I told him, "You do jail real well in Alabama." But the point being is, we opposed him, we opposed his nomination, we testified against him, but we're still willing to meet with him. It's important to engage the faculty and the administration. Now, I'm not saying that as a matter of being conciliatory. I'm saying that as a matter of being serious, thoughtful advocates. If somebody is a worthy opponent, they should also be a worthy discussant. They should be engaged in dialogue.
What does the NAACP intend to do about the missing Black and Latinx youth in Washington, D.C.?
So fortunately, we have in Washington a branch of the NAACP that is filled with millennials. that is engaged with the police department, and as we do with anything that involves a criminal investigation, we engage those charged with the responsibility of investigating crimes, and then we also look for not just the investigatory response, that is to say, what do the police do, but what do legislators do? So, for example, is there a reason why we have so many young people missing? Is in terms of criminal justice, is there a reason in terms of programming, education, the full gamut of responses? The point being here is that you don't want to engage a crisis in terms of a media window. And what I mean by that is we don't focus on things simply because it's trending on Twitter. It requires long-term engagement. And so, concrete example, these policing challenges, we don't take them on for the day, right? So in Ferguson, we were involved before Michael Brown lost his life. We had filed complaints against local prosecutors with the Justice Department before and afterwards. With these missing young women, it's going to take a sustained effort. Because here's the thing, it was a story before we became aware that it was a story.
These two are really about your formation, or your own formation in a sense. One is, how has Christianity informed your struggle for justice? And the other is there a particular incident in your life that made you realize the NAACP could play a critical role?
Sure. So let me start with the last question now and on Christianity. The role of the NAACP. If you don't mind, let me tell you a personal story. So when I was a young man, I used to get my hair cut in my grandfather's barbershop. My grandmother sent me to my grandfather, not because he gave fashionable haircuts, but he was cheap, as in free. But my grandfather used to tell me these stories about his activism within the NAACP. I didn't believe him at all. I thought he was telling tall tales. Many years later, I was at Yale Law School. Somebody passed around a book. In the book was a picture of a young man, and underneath it said these words, the Reverend James Edmund Prelo, candidate for Congress, 1946. I did the research, because my grandfather told me he was involved in politics, but I didn't really understand that. I didn't believe him. He ran for Congress because Thurgood Marshall took a case all the way up to the Supreme Court called Smith versus Allwright, which outlawed the all-white Southern Democratic primary. My grandfather, when the case came down to the federal district court, decided to run for Congress to get African Americans in the low country of South Carolina to register to vote and join the NAACP. Here's the point. The legacy of the NAACP spans generations. And I came to realize that the NAACP was not my granddaddy's organization. It's my organization. And what I'm trying to do right now is, as president and CEO of the NAACP, is to say to a 16-year-old or a 17-year-old or a 19-year-old, this is your NAACP, right? And when you have 2.2 million digital activists, most of whom are young, right, where we have more college chapters in colleges, we have chapters of colleges, high schools. We're the largest civil rights organization for young people outside of a religious body in the country now. Right? That's, people always think of the NAACP as this old, stodgy, senile organization to be relegated to the convalescent home for civil rights organizations. That, my friend, is not the facts. So that experience taught to me that the NAACP is a treasure. Right? That everybody has a role to play. With respect to Christianity, so I'm a fourth-generation preacher in the African Methodist Episcopal Church. And I would just simply say my faith is integral to everything I do. And what I mean by that is I would not be telling you the truth if I said I was simply motivated to do this work because of my Jewish prudential look or understanding of the law. I do this work because I believe in the innate worth of people, the innate worth of human beings. A lot of that comes out of my seminary training, my moral philosophy training, but my understanding, my notion that each of God's children has worth. And so when you see these hashtag videos of people being brutalized and mistreated and humiliated. That offends my sensibilities as a religious person. Now, I'm not alone in that. Hindus and Buddhists and Jews and folk of other faith traditions feel that way too. But I got to be honest with you, faith to me is a motivating force.
And you'll like this question. You don't have to answer it now. Would you come and preach at Amherst for the bi-semester worship service?
If we can get here, we'll try to do it.
Okay. What can parents do to make our young people aware of how to interact with police anytime they come in contact, given that their lives can depend on how they respond to police?
So there's a document on the NAACP called the 411 on the 50. This goes back years. We still have it. That explains how to interact with the police, how to balance asserting your constitutional rights with ensuring your safety. It's basically the digital version of the talk. For those of you who may not know what the talk is when African-American parents tell their young people how to interact with the police. Now, I'll share with you a funny story. I was riding home. Police car pulls up behind me. I pull over. Police officer walks up beside my car. I have my wallet open on the dashboard, all the windows down, interior light on, driver's license out, hands on the steering wheel at 9 o'clock and 11 o'clock. Police officer looks at me and says, why'd you pull over? I said, I pulled over because you pulled me over. He says, no, I'm not pulling you over. I'm actually driving home. He said, I'm your neighbor.
Two more. Okay. We're not going to get to all of them. I'm sorry. This is someone who says, asks, being of mixed ethnicity, my skin tone makes me look predominantly white, yet my father is an African immigrant and my mother is of Puerto Rican descent. What advice would you offer to someone who identifies as black and wishes to have their civil rights opinions taken seriously?
So, I think you said it was a woman, my sister? Okay. My sister or my brother, let me share with you this. So, Walter White served as president and CEO of the NAACP. He had red hair, blue eyes, and white skin. He witnessed lynchings. He served as an investigative reporter on behalf of the NAACP, and he occupied our highest position. He was no less or no more black than I am. Being black is a matter of how you identify. It's not a matter of biology. And that we know. And so when we think about people of, as we say, mixed ancestry, well, here's the reality. We're all of mixed ancestry. And so no one can challenge anyone's racial street cred. We got to be clear about that. And in the NAACP, we've taken heat for it. You know, we've had people say, well, you know, this person can be in leadership or not be in leadership based upon their color. Well, here's the reality. When the NAACP was founded, only a minority of our founders were African American. Only a minority. Most of them were white. And for the anti-Semites and the Ku Klux Klaners in the country, a good number of them were Jewish. So we're kind of used to people challenging our street cred, but for 108 years, we've simply said we are who we are and we refuse to apologize. And I would simply say, make that your personal credo as well.
This is a person who says they've noticed in the past few years the new woke society. There are many individuals in it who participate in internet wokeness, but off the internet, they don't contribute to the cause. How would you approach that, and what would you say to those people?
That is such a incisive question. We can't walk around mouthing the politically correct nomenclature then decline to actually speak to people, right? I mean, you know, to tweet with the eloquence and then not engage in the real battle. And here's what I mean. If you claim to love people, but you don't want to spend any time around them, you claim to advocate for communities, but don't want to engage in those communities, that's a problem. And it's a problem. It represents a kind of intellectual and social condescension. And so I believe one of the best things we can do is like literally encourage people to be present. Be present. And that means being in communities with people you claim to advocate for. And so we have to challenge people when they simply mouth the platitudes. And if you read Dr. King's works, he talks about this quite often. I mean, we cannot have people mouthing platitudes. And for those who simply want to tweet the revolution, we appreciate that. But I challenge you to go beyond it. And I think that one of the ways you can do that is helping people see the consequences of injustice and challenge them to really face that. Here's what I'm talking about. People talk about 2.2 million people behind bars. But I'll tell you something. When you have somebody walk into your office who's tatted up, who's gone through a really difficult life, and they tell you what they've been through, and you hear their story, and you connect with something in their story, because everybody's got a story that you can connect with if you truly listen as a human being. You can't stay where you are. You can't tweet about them as a problem to be fixed, but rather people to be engaged. And so one of the things that we try to do in the NAACP is literally move people to action. That's what we've been doing for 100 years, moving people to action. And we challenge folks. Note this. Social media is social. But social cannot be confined to digital. We got to move out of that space.
Thank you all for the questions. I thought they were great questions. I'm sorry we didn't get to all of them. Please join me in thanking Cornell William Brooks.